Hey you guys, John Rock at TV One here. And today, we are going to make a faceplate. But first, we'll talk a little bit about my Big Dog Mini Lathe, which evidently Big Dog has gone out of business. I don't know, I can't find him anymore, but back in 2010-11, when I started looking at these machines, I ended up, if you guys go through my page, you'll find, what do I have, a 93799 Hockey Frame. That thing blew fuses left and right. And that's because it used the Chinese controller board. If I'd known then what I know now, I don't believe I would have got this machine. I would have just, because only 6 months after having this machine, I acquired that Logan. I traded an antique rifle for it. And it was a good deal for me, because that machine is coming way handy. This machine has probably less than 50 hours worth of actual spindle time on it. And if you buy one of these machines, I think you can get some of the cheaper ones like off eBay, or you can certainly get them from Harbor Freight and probably get the 20% discount. I cannot speak to the quality of those machines other than the one that I had, which was the 714. It definitely had the Chinese controller board. This one has the KBIC controller made in Florida, USA. And I have another video on adjusting these to do a bunch of stuff. But for right now, we will talk about some of the accessories. This machine came with the steady rest and the follow rest. And the follow rest, I actually tried to use that one time to make a lead screw for this. It didn't work out too well. It was dragging the carriage width because the brass fingers were actually biting into the thread that I was cutting. And I just could not really make that work. I think that I have used tools in the post backwards on the back side of a pot when I was drilling a boring to make sure that I wasn't going to push nothing out of the way. And honestly, if you're taking a reasonable cut, you should probably not have to worry about that. If you are worried about it, your setup is no good. You're not in the chuck far enough. It's Krupinski in there or something. There's a guy on YouTube talking about putting a 5-inch chuck on there, and then he calls it epic fail or something, and the chuck pulls out because he used a piece of plastic for a back plate. That's definitely a no-no, because this thing will spin over 2,500. Not good. All that said, for the most part, this is a 7-inch swing by 14 between centers. It has the locking tailstock, the movable tailstock, which you can see I got some ends on there, and with some dressing of the parts and fitting, you can actually make that work pretty nice. I got some handles on there, and the extra weight of that handle makes it lock nice and move nice. This machine came with a drill chuck, half-inch drill chuck. Garbage. It's the same one that's on the wall with Harbor Freight, and that thing is Krupinski. No matter what you do with it, you can't hold a chuck in it, and the key that comes with it don't even fit. The rolling center that comes with this machine, live center, that thing there is Krupinski. No matter how many times I took the bearings out and tried to refit that thing in there, I could not make that thing straight, even over here. The beauty part of it is that this lathe and that lathe all have empty tube tailstocks, including my drill press, empty tube. So all my tools rotate around the garage here nicely. That's a bonus. The faceplate is another thing that did not come with this machine. However, it does come with some of the machines if you buy the package that way. And it makes them more expensive. And if you want to buy a faceplate for this machine, they're on eBay for $50 or $60 delivered to your house. However, I'm here to tell you that I made this one here, this faceplate, okay, which isn't quite done yet, but that's what you're going to see here on this next little part two of this video. I already have the recess in there. I did already drill and tap the holes. You know, you see guys doing these things by hand, and you know, if you got a drill press or a milling machine, start to tap in the spindle and get it going straight, and then, you know, back the spindle off and put your tap handle on there so they go straight. But the thing of that is you can make these, save yourself $50, give yourself a couple of hours of machine time, and make one out of one of these here 5-pounders. That's all this is made out of. It's made out of a 5-pounder. You guys back in 12 or 13 when I started making that Sterling engine, biggest beer can Sterling engine on the planet, I believe I named it, that's made out of one of these, okay? You saw me cut this on there. I think I called it cut a cast iron on a mini lathe. This machine will certainly do that if you set your tools up right. And this is a perfect little flywheel. It goes on, I had to make a nugget for it. It goes on, what the hell is that? I believe that's on a 7/16 shaft now. Perfect, spins perfect. Ain't no run out on that thing. But I mean, you can pick these up just about on the ground. You go by somebody's yacht sale or garage sale, they're on the ground. And if you needed one and you had to buy one brand new, they're probably $5 at Walmart. Oh, this is a billet. And I don't know what year this was made, but the cast iron with this, there ain't no inclusions in it at all. You know, I got a stack of them one year for next to nothing. There was no dirt in that. Unlike if, you know, if you're using a sash weight out of an old window from an old house, you will sometimes find that, you know, there's a little pothole in the back here, but it's in the back. I did make this pot on the Logan, on my new 6-inch four-jaw chuck. And I set the dimensions in the centers for the hole because I didn't feel like setting up the rotary table to bump these all out. And I was a little leery about, I have another headstock for one of these that I got picked up used. And that was so that I could do the bearings and, you know, and change to a 100mm spindle. This is the 80mm spindle with the 3-inch chuck. Speaking of chucks, there are guys that will put a 5-inch chuck on this machine. And just like if you go to the video that I'm going to have up there shortly, about the going from the 8-inch chuck, Cushman chuck, that came on that Logan machine to a 6-inch chuck. Logan supplied 6 inches. The throw on that machine is 11. For the most part, for any lathe, the factory supplied chuck is somewhere in the neighborhood of 2/3 of the swing. Any more than that, if you open it up with the outside jaws on, the jaws are going to bang the bed. And there is evidence of that on my 1952 Logan over there, which is, if you watch the other video, I talk about how, you know, if you're confident enough, yeah, you can get away with it. It may take certain machines, especially one with an AC motor, a little more time to spin up, a little more time to spin down. That machine had a brake, which I don't own. It was a piece of 2x4 and some inner tube. I got that. The reason that it's 2/3 is so that you're not banging jaws into the bed by opening them too far or getting too close with it. Because it will happen, it can happen, and it will happen. That being said, this is only a 7-inch swing machine. So if you can get a 4-jaw chuck, if you happen to buy one of these, which is a real bull machine, not seed. This is a real bull machine as opposed to a seed machine. I don't even know if you can buy them anymore. I think you can, but you got to do your hunting and your research. You can get a 100mm spindle now and a taper bearing kit, I believe they're selling. And the 100mm spindle will take a 100mm 4-inch and 5-inch chuck without the adapter plate. The adapter is you're gonna lose another 1/2 inch in here. And everything about this machine, you need everything in front. You stick a regular size drill bit, unless you're buying the shoddy screw machine drill bits, you are going to have a time as soon as you stick a real man's chuck in the back of that tailstock. As soon as you put one of those in there, everything you need, every ounce of length you can get. And then even if you've got it, just getting your dual post back far enough out of the way to get a full-size 1/2-inch chuck out of the way enough is tough. So there's a reason why a 100mm spindle exists, and there's a reason why the 5-inch chuck is well more than halfway to 7 inches of swing. You will definitely cram the jaws into the bed, if you're not paying attention. The 4-inch chuck is likely as big as you want to go on this machine. They will supply you with something just under 7 inches for the faceplate, which is what this is. This is gonna end up at, I forget yet, because I haven't finished the end off. I've been waiting to do that until it mounts onto here. So that being said, there are a lot of things about these mini lathes that, like I said, had I known what I know now, back when I got this, I would have spent my time and effort a couple of years more on that machine. That machine is about as done as I'm going to get, other than fixing some, you know, making some accessories for it, and some more gears for the quick change box, which if you saw and hit the bell, you'll see those videos on my channel about making gears for the gearbox. I'm making the gears. I'm not buying them. I'm not, we're making the gears. This is another accessory, speaking of gears, the change gears. This machine has metal gears in the headstock and metal change gears, which is what these are, all of them. The only plastic spool on this machine is the one from the motor to the headstock. It's the counter drive, and there is guys now selling underdrives, drive sets for this machine with an upgraded belt, which is likely the only reason why you would buy that, is for the ease and getting a more quality drive belt, cog belt, that is on this, comes on these machines stock. Every belt I have ever gotten from China has some sort of pothole speed bump in it that goes around every time. And it's going to break at the most inopportune time, and you'll either be able to, you'll either have one in your top draw or you won't. And molting is not good. However, if you have a machine that calls out that it has the K-bit controller in it, I have another video about this. The K-bit controller, electronic speed controller for this machine, has an adjustment. You can adjust up and down, and you can adjust the voltages. And I'm not going to tell you how to do that, especially in this video, because it's done with the lathe plugged in, and it's, you have to read the PDF file at K-bit on how to make this adjustment. However, this machine has dynamic braking. So even if you had a 5-inch chuck on here, with a chuck big as this, a foot out, even if it weighed a ton, you turn the machine off, and it's going to bring that right to a dead stop within a half a second. It's not going to spin for a year, all that dynamic braking. And you can use that for guys who, one of the only reasons that I would buy one of these is if I needed it on my kitchen table, or I was going to CNC it to make for a hobby thing. Mostly about how to build a CNC machine and not how to make accurate pots, because it's more about how to build a CNC machine. However, if you were CNC controlling the spindle on this machine and actually using the dynamic braking on this board, you would need to upgrade the heat sinks, because what it does is jam the power in the reverse direction and it causes a big heat inside the on the board, on the controller. And so you can only do that so many times before you stop building heat. And this is going to end up remotely located, so I could get my wheel pass there back a little further, get closer to the chuck. So all that being said, you know, hopefully this video is a little bit useful to guys thinking about getting one of these. This is probably one of the better machines that you can get. I want to say that I don't even know if Micromark is still making them anymore. I do know that Little Machine Shop has the Microluxes, whatever the machine, Little Machine Shop, whatever their brand is, they likely have a better quality control on their machines. However, I don't care which brand you buy. Every one of these is going to need some sort of work before you can go, I see guys spinning the handles and the machine's going like this on the bench. Yep, that ain't no good. The feet are nowhere near big enough. So really this wants to be bolted down to something absolutely straight, or at least have some bigger legs set put under it. Because going like this on your bench just ain't no good while you're screwing. Especially if you got it, because there's no power on the cross here to do a facing. I did make one of these. This is my milling slide. This goes, gets bolted. It's a 1/4-20 on the lead screw. It was made out pretty much scrap, but the slide itself came out pretty good. I think I even got oilers in it. Just a piece of angle iron milled off over there on my 40939 milling machine. Yeah, whatever that 626 hobby freight. I got the video on that over wherever that is there on YouTube these days. Yeah, good little thing, and well rugged enough for what this machine is. And you know, I might at some point get an angle plate, and then fix that up a little bit so that it takes that slide with rigidity. But I wanted to be able to set this on a machine and do some line barring with it, because I think that will come in handy. As far as milling parts on the milling pot itself, not so much because I got a mill, but. As far as, like I said, being able to get in here and maybe line board or a piece of tubing would be. If this video helped anybody out or you like more of these videos, please subscribe and hit the bell so you get more. I guess that's the way YouTube is doing it anymore these days. Hey, thanks for watching, you guys. Rocket TV1 said that.